The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 7996 in the name of Jackie Bailey on International Long COVID Day. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Jackie Bailey to open the debate around 7 minutes, please, Ms Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Wednesday the 15th of March, tomorrow, is International Long COVID Day. According to the ONS, over 175,000 people in Scotland have long COVID. 3 years on from the first wave of the virus in Scotland, people living with the condition feel let down by the Scottish Government. In the words of Anna, formerly from Dumbarton, and who has long COVID, the current government and its institutions have failed us. It is as if long COVID doesn't exist. In a briefing prior to the debate, Long COVID Scotland have outlined steps that the Scottish Government must take. Everything from data and research to specialist long COVID treatment hubs. And I commend their briefing to whoever is the incoming Cabinet Secretary for Health and ask that they sit down with Long COVID Scotland and Long COVID Scotland Kids as the voices of those with lived experience and come up with a plan for full implementation of their recommendations. The first area I want to touch on is funding. When £3 million of funding for long COVID was first announced, there were 74,000 people reported as having the condition. That number has almost trebled, but the money has remained the same. The services that will help with long COVID also apply to people with ME and chronic fatigue syndrome. Many of the symptoms are similar, and this could be a real opportunity to create tangible change for all of those living with energy-limiting, fluctuating chronic illnesses in Scotland. And I hope it is an opportunity that the government will seize. Now, the £3 million was shared out between each of the health boards for treatment of long COVID, and to be frank, it wasn't enough. A Freedom of Information request that I submitted last year showed that not one health board was awarded all the funding that they believe they need to treat the condition. And the uncertainty around funding levels has created a significant barrier to implementing treatment plans, and the length of time it took for the Scottish Government to actually release funds left delays of over a year for people to access services. Of course.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Jackie Bailey for taking my intervention. Does she agree with me that there's glacial progress to get money out to health boards, and the small nature of the quantum funding is actually keeping us back, and that actually right now in health boards in England and indeed in Wales, they are much further on in terms of providing care pathways for sufferers of this terrible condition?
Jackie Bailey.
I absolutely agree with that contention by Alex Cole-Hamilton. He should have also added that there's no consistency in provision, and it very much does depend on where you live as to the services provided, a classic postcode lottery. But to take up his point further, as of May 2022, NHS England had allocated £224 million to support the assessment and treatment of long COVID. £90 million of this was allocated in 2022-23. Applying the Barnett formula to these figures would produce funding of £21.7 million in Scotland. Yet the SNP government have only provided a fraction of this amount. Where, Presiding Officer, are the missing millions? The Scottish Government should also collect better data on the number of people living with long COVID, including children and young people. Health boards that responded to the COVID-19 committee's long COVID inquiry have stated that one of the biggest barriers to service provision has been a lack of public health data around the condition. Health boards cannot accurately treat this condition if they do not know the scale of the problem, and there is absolutely no excuse for not collecting the data. COVID is still with us, and so too is long COVID.
Martin Whitfield,
my colleague at the back.
I'm very grateful to Jackie Bailey giving way on that point. And the additional challenge with the lack of data is that young people and their education is being affected, as schools are unable to identify those people with long COVID and put in place recognisable strategies that will help with their education.
Jackie Bailey.
I very much agree, and that reminds me of the suggestion from the Scottish Government at the time that we should cut off the bottom or the top of doors to increase ventilation. I mean, we really need to be serious about how we treat COVID in the classrooms. But long COVID can be utterly debilitating, and I very much welcome the COVID-19 Committee's inquiry into long COVID. One respondent to their call for evidence said, you know, I cannot stand in the shower. I often can't get dressed or washed. I can't stand for longer than 10 minutes without pain. And symptoms, memory issues have resulted in me forgetting to turn off the oven or blow out candles. I am unfit for work. Previously healthy children are now confined to wheelchairs. Doctors and other frontline healthcare workers have lost their jobs because they've been exposed to long COVID. And whilst people with long COVID remain untreated, their ability to work diminishes each and every day. In a survey carried out by the...
Murdo Fraser.
I'm grateful to Jackie Bailey for giving way. Just on the point she's raised about the COVID Recovery Committee and the evidence we've heard on long COVID, just to share my concern about the evidence we've heard that many people cannot get proper understanding from their GPs as to long COVID, leaving too many having to go private and pay to get a treatment that they should be getting for free under the NHS.
Jackie Bailey.
The member raises absolutely an important point. My understanding is 1 in 5 people with long COVID have actually sought private medical treatment because they're not getting the tests or the treatment, whether it's from their GP or whether it indeed is from acute services. Let me develop the point about people in work, because in a survey carried out by the Key Worker Petition UK team, 57% of key worker respondents said they can no longer work, and 68% said that they were struggling financially. These are the NHS staff that caught COVID at work due to a lack of PPE, who now face losing their jobs because of their illness. The Scottish Government clapped for them during the pandemic, but now fails to offer decent funding for treatment and stands by whilst their employment and source of income look set to be removed. The Scottish Government should treat long COVID as an industrial injury, and I commend Mark Griffin's Members' Bill on creating a statutory Employment Injuries Council, which should include long COVID. There also needs to be guidance put in place for employers to support people effectively and to ensure that they are meeting the legal rights of disabled workers. And the government must ensure that it places those with lived experience at the very heart of all decision making, nationally and locally, and they're involved in the design, development, delivery, review and evaluation of services. Finally, I want to finish with the words of Cass MacDonald, a nurse from Edinburgh. And Cass said, key workers with occupational long COVID have literally been left to rot. We are losing pay and our careers are in jeopardy. I'm losing my home because I can't work and I don't know if I'll ever get back to my job. COVID and long COVID have taken everything from me. Career, home, savings, everything. I don't mind being disabled, but this is a shadow of a life. I'm not well enough to renew my nursing registration this year. My career is over. I often feel like I'm being punished by government and healthcare for neither dying nor getting better. That's a horrible limbo to exist in. We're being told there's all this support, all this money being put into healthcare, but where? There's nothing in my area. We need action from the Scottish Government, not warm words. Presiding Officer, people with long COVID are not just going to go away. They absolutely deserve support from this government.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. I would advise members that obviously there's a lot of interest in speaking in this debate, and I would be keen to take everybody who has pressed the button, but I would ask for some cooperation and that members should seek to stick to their allotted time. And on that note, I call John Mason to be followed by Sandesh Gohani. Mr Mason.
Thank you very much. And I thank Jackie Bailey for bringing this debate today. At the COVID Recovery Committee, of which I'm a member, we have been looking at long COVID and have heard from quite a number of sufferers and their families about the extremely challenging time they have been facing. Our thoughts are with all of them today, and it is appropriate that we're having this debate with International Long COVID Day being tomorrow. Awareness of long COVID is gradually increasing, but clearly it is still the case that amongst the public as a whole, GPs and others, some are much more familiar with it than others. I know that those directly affected find this rate of progress frustrating. However, I do think we're moving in the right direction. Research is ongoing, and last week at committee we were hearing about the 9 Scottish-led studies which are ongoing. I personally was particularly impressed to hear about the work of Professor Chris Robertson. He and his team at the University of Strathclyde have been studying over 5 million health records in Scotland, which I personally had not even realised was possible. Even if a GP has not actually diagnosed long COVID and coded it as such, the team have been able to trawl through the free text and pick up symptoms and queries in the GP's notes. Professor Robertson's paper was published recently in The Lancet, and for example, they found that more cases of long COVID have come from the Alpha and Delta variants, while fewer are from Omicron. Perhaps we should not be surprised to know that Scotland has a world-class amount of data and quality of data. At the same time, I accept that we have further to go on sharing that data. Moving on to the wording of the motion itself, I very much agree that we want to see more treatments available, more support, and more clinical research. What I do not agree with is Jackie Bailey's attack on localisation and on making services fit the needs of the local population. She claims that this is a lottery, as if health boards were pulling solutions out of a hat at random. I think that is insulting to health boards and professionals. Labour has had a history of top-down, very centralised approach, and I think we need to strongly oppose that. Just because something works in Dumbarton does not mean that it is the right answer in Dundee, Dumfries or Durness. Yes, absolutely.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Grateful to John Mason for giving way. I'm delighted to hear his conversion to localism, and perhaps he'll now join my party in opposing the power grab of asset stripping local communities in the shape of the National Care Service.
John Mason.
I think Alec Cole-Hamilton's in the wrong debate. The COVID committee has not reached any conclusions, and we are due to hear from the Cabinet Secretary next week. However, the subject of long COVID clinics is certainly on our agenda. A number of people do feel that the grass is greener across the border, and think that we should be copying what they do in England. However, I think the jury is still out on such specialised clinics. The disadvantages of such an approach could include the shortage of specialist staff, and so the danger of diverting staff away from other critical parts of the health service. Also, the high cost per patient of these clinics, and the risk of conditions other than long COVID being missed. On the other hand, a single point of contact for patients does seem to be eminently sensible, so that they have one specific person they can go to with problems. Evidence from England suggested that those with long COVID still have to go through their GP in the first instance before accessing a long COVID clinic, whereas in Wales they do have a self-referral model, which appears to do well. But to finish on what I hope we can all agree on, we must continue to focus on long COVID, even as other medical issues come along. ME has been with us for a very long time now, and we have not made the progress in understanding it or dealing with it, which I think many of us feel we should have. There may not be one magic wand to deal with long COVID or to answer the needs of those suffering from it. However, we must do all we can to research, to support and to treat those affected by it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. I now call Sandesh Gohani to be followed by Mark Griffin. Dr Gohani.
Thank you. And I'd like to thank my long COVID CPG co-convener for bringing this debate. On the 1st of March 2020, Scotland confirmed its first case of COVID-19, and I wish to pay my respects to the friends and families of the 17,000 Scots who died after contracting this horrible virus, and also to our heroic frontline staff who've treated and looked after patients throughout this pandemic. Tomorrow is International Long COVID Day, and we're focused on the rapidly growing number of Scots who survived COVID but are still yet to make a recovery. If we cast our minds back to the summer of 2020, just a few months after our first lockdown, it was clear we were dealing with a new long-term chronic debilitating condition. Month in, month out, at my GP surgery, more and more patients were presenting with fatigue, dizziness, brain fog, pain in their joints, poor mental health. The alarm bells were ringing. but the Scottish Government paid scant attention. In this chamber, I underscored the urgent need for action to support long COVID patients. I also proposed a tried and tested solution to establish multi-specialty long COVID clinics based on the successful Hertfordshire model. But all our patients got was a mediocre response from the SNP Green Government and its current Health Secretary. In the same month that the Scottish Government produced its long COVID response plan, there were 79,000 people suffering from long COVID. But after 8 months of dither and delay by the Scottish Government, that had risen to 150,000. This is what you get with a continuity candidate, the first activist, if you will. Announcements, inertia, but very little in the way of delivery. Today, an estimated 175,000 Scots are struggling with long COVID. The Cabinet Secretary provided me with a list of initiatives that he's funding to the tune of £3 million this year across Scotland's Health Board, including £20,000 for public health intelligence gathering in the Western Isles, £120,000 for self-management resources and peer support in the Highlands, and £178,000 to develop a long COVID rehabilitation pathway in Fife. But there's a lack of consistency with this approach. It's not streamlined, and there's a danger of exacerbating the postcode lottery in long COVID support. This is not localism, as John Mason suggests. Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland calls for a national approach to ensure all health boards are able to provide a multidisciplinary care and integrated referrals to the third sector. No one should be told they have no access to support, as is happening in some of our communities today. I appeal to the new Cabinet Secretary for Health come the end of the month to listen to the terrific long COVID patient advocates like Long COVID Scotland. They know what they're talking about. Long COVID Scotland is essentially calling for what I proposed in September 21, the establishment of a network of specialist long COVID treatment hubs. There should be published clear referral pathways. Meaningful, holistic treatment must be available. Diagnostic tests and biomedical investigations should be the norm. There should be better guidance for employers so they can support their employees effectively. And people with lived experience must be at the heart of all decision-making, nationally and locally, and be involved in the design, development, delivery, review and evaluation of services. NHS staff are going above and beyond, but they cannot provide the service patients deserve because this SNP Green Government has failed to tackle long COVID head on. Tackling long COVID effectively and with consistency is of vital importance for the whole of Scotland to speed its recovery from the coronavirus pandemic. I declare my interest as a practicing NHS doctor who struggles to get my patients into long COVID clinics.
Thank you, Dr. Gohani. I call Mark Griffin to be followed by Alex Gough-Hamilton. Mr. Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to welcome the debate marking International Long COVID Day and also recognise the tireless campaign and work that Jackie Bailey has done for those suffering with long COVID. Long COVID is a devastating, disabling disease, but we should be absolutely clear that for many, many thousands, it's an industrial disease. Lives and livelihoods have been consumed by the relentless, horrifically common symptoms, including brain fog, breathlessness, extreme fatigue, constant dizziness, and joint pain. So I welcome the motion today and agree that those suffering from long COVID should be compensated. Now, members might know that the starting point for my Members' Bill, which would establish a Scottish Advisory Council to make sure the employment injuries system that we have is fit for purpose in 21st century Scotland. And that starting point was back in 2020 when I asked key workers, academics, unions and ministers whether long COVID should be classified as an industrial disease. The answer back then was an overwhelming yes, and the evidence now means that case is absolutely undeniable. Now, given that many caught COVID at work while simply doing their job, when we were safe isolating at home, the condition has now virtually destroyed their ability to return. Last week, many of us will have heard from nurse Brenda Eady in the front page of the Daily Record that long COVID has left her penniless, having to give up her job in Low Moss Prison Brenda's harrowing story was echoed by another nurse who highlighted that without a financial miracle, she would be unlikely to make it through the year. Frontline workers, putting their health and well-being on the line for all of us during the pandemic, now suffering in devastating circumstances in absolute financial hardship. Now, you wouldn't know it, but employment injuries is fully devolved to the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Advisory Council that could recommend long COVID becoming an industrial disease doesn't exist, and we don't know when that benefit will launch. And although I plan on lodging that member's bill in a matter of weeks now, I am saddened that that won't be soon enough to help the countless workers suffering right now, because in recent weeks I've learnt of care workers who simply can't do their jobs anymore because they don't have the strength to lift people or cope with a full day's work. They're being retired, or worse still, they're being dismissed from their jobs on ill health grounds for something they caught at their work. Now, the fact is, too many people have been ignored by their employers, all the while governments offering little more than warm words. And the Scottish Government's own action is absolutely dismal. It certainly doesn't match its rhetoric on supporting disabled people, seeking to give them dignity, fairness and respect they deserve. They recently told me that it only just started tracking its own long COVID staff absences in July 2022, continuing that theme from other speakers of a failure to track those suffering from long COVID. And when I first asked the then Social Security Cabinet Secretary whether the government would use its powers to recognise workers with long COVID in its planned employment injuries benefit, the response was utterly appalling. Rather than using the devolved powers that we have, she said that they should make a PIP claim with the DWP. Now, the idea that someone with long COVID should apply for PIP with the DWP, forcing them into a traumatic, cruel process at the hands of an organisation that systematically discounts their illness is absolutely horrifying. With numbers suffering from the disease nearly 200,000, it's devastating that just 422 people have made a successful claim by October last year. And to make matters worse for the new Scottish benefit, the Scottish Government simply can't say who's getting support under the adult disability payment from long COVID, because again, it doesn't track the statistics of those who have the condition. Presiding Officer, it shouldn't take a member's bill, but if that is one of the ways we can give people with long COVID the dignity, fairness and respect they deserve, then so be it, and I look forward to engaging in that debate when I lodge that bill.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by welcoming the sufferers of long COVID who I know are watching this debate, both online and in the gallery. Many are too ill to leave their homes, and it is to them in whose name we speak. I'd like to thank my friend Jackie Bailey for bringing this debate to the Chamber. And I'd also remind the Chamber that this is only the second time that this Parliament has debated this debilitating condition. The first was in a debate in my name over a year ago. And I look forward to the fact, and I hope very much, that the next time we come to debate it, it will be in normal business in government time. And it will be a signal, I think, to everybody suffering that this government is finally taking this issue seriously. Presiding Officer, I arrive at today's debate with a deep sense of anger. And it's an anger I feel on behalf of the many thousands of people in my constituency, in your constituency, who are suffering with long COVID right now. As of today, as we've heard, 175,000 of them and more, making this the largest mass disabling event since the end of the First World War. And if you listen to their stories, you can't help but join me in that anger. At the age of 45, my constituent, Will, was at the height of a busy and successful career when he caught COVID in March 2020. He's a long hauler. He thought he'd got off lightly, but sadly, he was wrong. Over the three grueling years since, long COVID has incrementally destroyed both his health and his life. He has been forced to stop work and describes his long list of symptoms and, as I quote, a desperate rotation of misery. And he wrestles daily with cognitive problems, GI issues, visual problems, breathing difficulties, crushing fatigue, and chest pain. He says it's a challenge even just to eat a bowl of soup due to his hands still shaking so violently. This government promised him help. They promised him clinical support, and yet they have not delivered. Presiding officer, when I ask the government what they are doing to support people like Will, they point to primary care. But he is still one of many people who sought help via primary care. He tried numerous GPs, and every time he was told there was just no clinical pathway for him. That's immeasurably cruel. It would seem that the principal strategy of this government towards sufferers of long COVID at this moment is to gaslight them, to pretend that there is help available or pathways available, only for them to find there is nothing. And thousands of long COVID patients have the same story to tell. At the moment, or at the long COVID inquiry last week, Dr. Janet Scott was asked how she thought Scotland was doing in terms of getting people into a correct treatment pathway. She said that she describes the current situation as being, and I quote, pretty dreadful. Good work is being done. Of course, we've heard some of this by Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland, but their helpline is still undersubscribed and NHS referrals are indeed low. Will has now given up waiting for help. He's even paid thousands of pounds for private medical care and knows others who have done the same, but many cannot afford to access private medical care. So desperate are they to make any sort of progress towards their health, people are trying everything. That is a damning indictment of this government's failure to help those who are suffering. Nor is there sufficient understanding of the paediatric component of long COVID. Some health boards were not even aware of long COVID in children until this year, 3 years into the pandemic. That is astonishing. While the Royal College of Paediatrics has said that there is no specific service aimed at children and young people in Scotland. Children and young people. Tens of thousands of them. Presiding officer, I've met children who have gone from winning ski competitions to being bound to a wheelchair because of this condition. The lack even of basic awareness, not to mention proper treatment for these young people, is appalling. The SNP Green government is spending just £17 per head, that's it, to tackle long COVID in Scotland. That's the price of a takeaway. And it's less than a fifth of the money available in England and Wales. Sufferers here would be better off moving south. One of the reasons health boards are reticent to publish any sort of treatment pathway is that they know the severe lack of funding means they do not have the ability to meet the huge need and capacity demand across this country. How on earth are we here 3 years on from the start of the pandemic, and this is where we find ourselves? And this is having an impact on our economy as well, with labour market statistics released today showing that the number of working age people economically inactive due to ill health is the only metric going up. And you can bet a lot of them have long COVID. And I support Mark Giffen's bill in terms of making it an industrial injury. People have had enough of the empty platitudes, and this government must immediately increase funding as a matter of urgency, create clear treatment pathways and publicise them, and ensure meaningful diagnostics and holistic treatment informed by the lived experience of those sufferers of long COVID, and make sure that's available to everyone with a condition, no matter who they are or where they are. Finally, presiding officer, the severe lack of leadership by Humza Yousaf means it is being left to people with long COVID themselves to fight this battle alone. They are being abandoned and their recovery is being harmed. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. I now call Gillian Mackay to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Many others have done. I'd like to thank Jackie Bailey for bringing this important debate forward. Long COVID is a condition which occurs after a mild, severe or asymptomatic COVID-19 infection and can cause a wide range of symptoms across the body. Long COVID can be a multi-system illness causing organ damage, cognitive dysfunction, gastrointestinal, respiratory, cardiac, nervous and musculoskeletal problems. It can affect anyone of any age, including children, irrespective of their previous health. As we mark the first International Long COVID Awareness Day, there is an estimated 175,000 people in Scotland living with long COVID. As long as COVID is with us, the potential for more people to develop long COVID is a real and present danger. And we should always take these opportunities to encourage everyone to take the basic infection control measures that can help keep everyone safe. Continue to make sure you're washing your hands thoroughly. If you are ill, you should try to stay at home. As we've reopened after lockdowns, many have gone back to normal, and I'm sure many in the chamber and those watching the proceedings here this evening will have witnessed visibly ill people out and about. For many, we know that staying home when you're ill isn't a reality, especially during a cost of living crisis, and we need to challenge employment practices that are inflexible and potentially putting their staff in harm's way. Anything we can do to reduce transmission will ultimately mean less people will develop long COVID. I wanted to thank all the long COVID groups that have been in touch with briefings ahead of today. Every single person involved should be really proud of the effect that they are having on the direction of long COVID care. There are a few asks of the groups that I would like to focus on. Long COVID care and knowledge is likely to develop for many years to come. We need to make sure that we're accurately capturing data of long COVID. For many who contracted long COVID during the first wave of the pandemic, because they lack the positive test, they may not immediately get a diagnosis of long COVID. We need to ensure that the clinical guidance is robust so that people in these circumstances are given the appropriate diagnosis and that lack of a positive test when they couldn't have actually had a test is not a barrier to that appropriate diagnosis. We need to make sure that we know who, how many people and where those people live so that services can be planned to support them. Many of those suffering are children and will likely need support for many years, and services need to be able to keep up with that demand. Due to the high numbers, we may have always struggled to upscale services quickly enough to meet the demand for the number of people who are now experiencing long COVID. But ensuring that those experiencing symptoms are able to voice their experience and access the support they feel they need is imperative. We also need to make sure that scientific studies are representative of all of those who are living with long COVID to ensure that treatments are appropriate for all. We know that too often in the past, studies haven't been representative of, for example, women, ethnic minority groups and those with disabilities or health conditions that may have put them at greater risk of COVID in the first place. We also need to make sure that GPs and other professionals have protected time to update their knowledge as COVID knowledge updates. There are many conditions, including undoubtedly long COVID, that would benefit from this approach. And a move to electronic prescribing, for example, might be able to free up some time to be able to accommodate this. And I know there will be many competing priorities for any freed up time, so some more creative solutions may need to be found. Campaigners are also asking for proper diagnostic testing and not just rehab. Due to the multi-system nature of COVID, it is possible to have damage to more than one organ or process within the body. While general rehab may work for some, I think it makes sense that ensuring appropriate diagnostic testing, such as scans, happen to ensure the damage is known and appropriately supported. I think this could be especially important as we know so little. We have no idea whether for some this may resolve or whether for some these symptoms may get worse. And if we do not have people's baseline correctly documented, we cannot hope to make projections and advice for anyone who may come after. I realise I'm out of time, Presiding Officer, so I'd once again like to thank Jackie Bailey for bringing this debate forward.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I first want to congratulate Jackie Bailey for securing this members' debate. I was invited to the Long COVID Peer Support Group in Inverclyde last month, and the group meet every Wednesday at Your Voice in Greenock between 1 p.m. and 3 p.m. and anyone suffering with the effects of long COVID is welcome to attend and seek support from others dealing with this horrible condition. And what I heard that day will live with me for many, many years to come. I was generally taken aback by the number of symptoms that each of the individual informed me that they actually had. Each attendee had written down their symptoms and provided me with a copy. They were all different, some experiencing a few and some experiencing a lot. There were people there who have lost their jobs and some currently struggling to actually maintain their employment. This is where I think the point regarding guidance, that whether guidance does or doesn't come, surely every single employer has got a duty of care to their staff, in addition to employment law, to actually try to assist their staff to keep their staff in employment. Now, one of the ladies who has lost her job has given me permission to speak about her situation today. She was admitted to the Inverclyde Royal Hospital, IRH, in January 2021. She was initially put on a CPAP machine, but this did not provide the level of intervention that was required, and she was transferred to Glasgow to be put onto a ventilator. The same outcome happened in Glasgow, so she was then transferred to Aberdeen to be put on an ECMO machine. The lady has no recollection of the period from when she left at IRH in January until she was transferred back in March. And during this time, her mother passed away from COVID. And due to the restrictions, she watched her mother's funeral on a live stream on her own in a hospital room. And due to the lasting effects COVID has had on her body, She now struggles on a daily basis. She's married with 3 children and worked in a local school. Her family have had to endure the loss of a loved one and the prospect, on a number of occasions, of losing her. She can now no longer work, and her ability to do day-to-day tasks has severely diminished, and she is truly suffering, physically and mentally, from the effects of long COVID. Her main concern now is it being seen by medical professionals and feeling that she is actually being listened to, but also being to be understood. Now, she, along with the other attendees at the group, spoke about not feeling listened to and being repeatedly given the same tests and thus the same results. She is very keen to be involved in any research to look at how better we can understand and treat long COVID. And I'll put on record how thankful I am to this lady, who I've chosen not to name, for giving me permission, just to touch upon some of her story today. And I think that what this lady's story tells us is that while long COVID generally discusses the medical effects on a person, long COVID is clearly also linked to the emotional trauma we all individually and as collectively went through during the pandemic. Now, long COVID, I imagine, will last for many, many years to come, as we all learn to live with the effects of an experience we all hope and pray will never happen again. And I know that the Scottish Government is investing a record amount of money into our NHS, and this is more than welcome and highlights the Government's commitment to improving our national health service. However, as we see across the world, health services are struggling. Now, I believe preventative spending is vital, and not only better for the individual, but better for the country and also its finances. And if we don't do more to help those experiencing the effects of long COVID now, intervention for some will come too late, and much more finance and resource could be used in an ineffective way further down the line. Now, that being said, I very much welcome that the Scottish Government is investing in long COVID research. The Chief Scientist Office is funding 9 Scottish-led studies totaling £2.5 million, which aim to improve the understanding of the long-term effects of COVID-19 on the physical and mental well-being. The projects are very much progressing and are around the midpoint of the stage of their 22 to 24 months duration. Presiding Officer, in closing, I welcome the work underway in Scotland to support and improve the lives of those struggling with the effects of long COVID. However, from the conversations I have had, from those living with the condition, and no doubt the additional conversations I will have coming, more can and must be done. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McMillan. Before I call the next speaker, I would advise members that due to the number of members who still wish to speak in this debate, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I now invite Jackie Bailey to move a motion without notice. Ms. Bailey.
So moved.
Thank you very much indeed. Do members agree to extend the debate this evening?
Yes.
Members do agree. That is agreed. I now call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Jackie Bailey for bringing this motion to Chamber ahead of International Long COVID Day, which takes place tomorrow, the 15th of March. For far too long, the issue of long COVID has not been viewed with the significance that it should be. In the past, the perception has sometimes been that COVID could be a debilitating disease for up to several weeks. We know, however, that many people have suffered continually from this area. Every time long COVID is raised in Parliament, we hear even higher statistics which highlight how many Scots are currently suffering from the condition. Indeed, Jackie Bailey's motion speaks about the estimated 175,000 people living with long COVID. We all know that COVID has not gone away, Presiding Officer, and so this is a continuing issue, and we know it's going to continue to rise. We have seen that long COVID can take different forms for different people with different conditions, and we know that it affects different organs, different groups, and therefore many different parts of someone's life can be affected. Of course, the nature of the condition has also meant that long COVID inevitably more difficult to diagnose and even more difficult to define. But we do know that symptoms like chronic fatigue, painful joints, dizziness, decreasing mental health are many issues that we have to suffer and individuals have suffered from. The issue of decreasing mental health is particularly acute for long COVID sufferers who may find life much more stressful, much more anxiety, even many suffering from PTSD in some cases. There are countless examples of fit, young, healthy individuals who have found themselves no longer able to live normal lives for months, for even years, who have suffered from COVID. As part of International Long COVID Day, those with the condition have been encouraged to share an image of something they can no longer do because of long COVID. This is perhaps one of the best ways to demonstrate how the condition reaches into every corner of people's lives. Presiding officer, today's debate has been an opportunity to reflect on what has undoubtedly been one of the pandemic's worst legacies. It should also be the opportunity to reflect on how we can tackle things. For the last 18 months, my colleague, Dr. Sandesh Gulhani, has been raising the plight of long COVID sufferers and the need for a dedicated long COVID clinics to be established. Despite promises of additional funding, we have still not seen these materialise. Dr. Gulhani has pointed out that always that COVID was going to be an issue to deal with. It wasn't something that was going to just happen and be dealt with. It was going to have consequences, and these consequences are still here. Despite now being nearly 3 years down the line, we are still waiting for dedicated specialist services, and that is a crying shame for the people who are suffering on a day-to-day basis. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, action must now be taken, and it's long overdue that the time and the voices of people who are suffering should be heard and must be heard. With initiatives such as International Long COVID Day now being recognised, I am at least hopeful that we will not have to wait too long for further action to be received. The government must act, and must act now, to assist, support and ensure that people with long COVID are supported and respected and looked after. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I now call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Emma Harper. Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to thank my colleague Jackie Bailey for bringing this important issue to the Chamber today. Long COVID is not simply a long recovery time for COVID-19, nor it is an occasional feeling of fatigue or sickness following a COVID-19 infection. This is a common misunderstanding. Long COVID is a complex, multi-system neuroimmune illness that currently has no known cure. A recent ONS survey showed that an estimated 2.3 million people in the UK suffer from long COVID. And a recent BBC Panorama documentary estimated that nearly 10,000 NHS workers are currently absent because of long COVID. One of my constituents, Marie Claire, is an NHS doctor in Edinburgh. Marie Claire has told me that the overwhelming response from the colleagues was that they often had little understanding of the severity of specific of the illness. Marie Claire also suffers from long COVID. There is a growing stigma about long COVID within the medical community and wider society. She has told me patients are actually having to educate their medical professionals on this debilitating illness in order to get help. Another one of my constituents, Cass MacDonald, was a full-time NHS nurse who contracted COVID-19 while working in an out-of-office nursing role in Edinburgh. Despite having multiple underlying health conditions and being told to shield by the Scottish Government's advice, the same government still advised it was safe for NHS staff to come to work. Cass has been living with long COVID ever since and is unable to go back to full-time work. Since COVID special leave has ended, Cass is now on a standard sick pay, which has been halved this month and will be stopped altogether in September. Cass has also been told, due to their financial circumstance, their only option is to declare themselves bankrupt or sell their home. The Key Worker Petition UK team's recently survey showed that Cass is part of the 20% of key workers in the UK with long COVID who said they were at risk of losing their home due to financial circumstance. Like many others, Cass has experienced frustration within the health service due to lack of awareness surrounding the health impacts of long COVID. Tomorrow, CAS and other key workers will deliver a petition in London urging the UK government to create a pension and compensation scheme for all key workers who have developed long COVID as a result of their frontline work during the pandemic. This petition already has over 118,000 backers. The Scottish Government must be part of the process to help stop the stigma around the long COVID. It must do more to ensure adequate support for key workers who are desperately struggling due to long COVID. It must do more to increase public awareness of the danger of long COVID and help people like Cass, Marie Claire, and other thousands of others suffering from long COVID across Scotland. And again, I thank my colleague, Jackie Bailey, for bringing this to the Chamber. Thank you. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Brian Whittle. Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Jackie Bailey also for bringing this debate to Chamber this evening. And we've heard more and more from COVID-19 survivors that the impact of the virus lasts beyond the first few weeks of immediate symptoms. And for some patients, COVID-19 has a long-term, far-reaching impact on their daily lives, impacting them physically, emotionally and cognitively. And members have spoken about this already. And post-COVID syndrome, now referred to as long COVID, presents a variety of symptoms. These range from physical symptoms such as pulmonary, cardiovascular and systemic issues like extreme fatigue to neuropsychological symptoms impacting cognition, speech, memory and emotion. And I know members have described this already. And because I'm, I think, one of the final speakers, it is hard to come up with something different or reflect on something. But I would be interested in like following up on the, you know, the whole varied and the symptoms demonstrate that COVID is, or long COVID is, really, really complex, and much is still not known about how COVID-19 will affect people over time. But research is ongoing and must be supported. And Stuart McMillan has mentioned research already that is undertaken, and I've got research right in front of me from the, it's a COVID in Scotland study, where it's a large cohort of study people were involved in this. 33,281 laboratory confirmed SARS-CoV-2 infections as part of this study, but also these people were matched with 62,957 never infected individuals. So this study has looked at the wide range of people that have had COVID and some that haven't had COVID, and to look at the results that are coming out has been quite interesting to read this, but I won't repeat the whole study that I have in front of me, Presiding Officer. But I know it is crucial that we think about the real life experiences, we involve the real life experience of people living with long COVID, and we need to continue to use that to inform the Scottish Government's approach for support, and we need to look at where the support is most required. I was also reading about what Chest Heart Stroke Scotland are doing, working with NHS Lothian, Pogo Digital Healthcare and patients with long COVID to develop a pathway for long COVID. And the pathway is aimed to give patients access to this My Tailored Talks digital platform and have advice from Chest Heart Stroke Scotland with their long COVID support service. So in reading about this, they're looking at engaging with people to hear about their symptoms. They make a self-assessment of their symptoms, and that allows them to be directed to particular specialists, because as we've heard, different specialists will deal with different symptoms. So for me, Presiding Officer, it is interesting to also pick up on what the Office of National Statistics talk about with the prevalence of long COVID. 85% of female workforce in social care, education, 68% are female workforce, and in healthcare, 76% female workforce. I think 85% social care, 68% female in workforce in education, and 76% female workforce in healthcare. So long COVID impacts women more than in other areas, and this obviously presents challenges for the women's labour market in participation, particularly as employer responses to long COVID have maybe not been as particularly supportive of the women workforce. And according to the TUC, they found that 52% of respondents to their study said that they had the female workforce had experienced some type of discrimination or disadvantage due to long COVID. I would be interested, Presiding Officer, whether the Minister is pursuing any specific long COVID pathways into treatment for women, and ask if that's something that any further analysis could be done to look at the impact on gender. And I'll stop there, Presiding Officer, because obviously this is a wide-ranging subject, and I think I could have easily gone on for longer. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Carol Mockin. Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank Jackie Bailey for bringing this debate to the Chamber and allowing us to discuss this? And I'm a member of the COVID Recovery Committee, who are currently investigating long COVID and the approach to long COVID from the Scottish Government. We've taken evidence from many long COVID sufferers, and for sure it is a crippling, or can be a crippling, condition. It can severely restrict a person's ability to work or even to take part in what we would class as everyday activities. It can be extremely debilitating. The problem, of course, is that, in, as has been highlighted in today, is that what many employment, those in employment, it's not taken seriously. And when they have to continually take absence from work, it impacts their ability to do that work and potentially endangering employment. Now, the problem is there's multiple symptoms in long COVID. There can be, you know, recurring chest pain and brain fog and abdominal pain and extreme fatigue and neurological conditions. And if you're suffering from that, if you're having recurring chest pain, if you're having a recurring abdominal pain or any of these other conditions, you better believe that you want to get that seen to, because of course that is extremely, extremely worrying. You need to get to see a GP. Now, we know that the NHS is under extreme pressure and that access to GPs is not potentially all it can be in certain areas. And even if you get to see a GP, there are those GPs who potentially don't accept that long COVID is a condition. And even if they do accept it as a condition, they have no place to signpost them. Now, that now has been said before, many have ended up having to pay private health to get a diagnosis or even treatment. And of course, that's leading to a significant inequality that we know already exists. And interestingly, we heard from chest, heart and stroke during an evidence to say, actually, they are treating long COVID and they have capacity, but obviously they're not getting referred to because the GPs don't currently recognise or realise that chest, heart and stroke actually are a potential designation. So my assertion here is around the need to develop the health IT system to not only accumulate that data from research, which actually Scotland has an excellent reputation, but they need to deploy that data in an effective way, which actually we're not particularly good at. And I think that COVID has highlighted a problem we already had to deal with, and that is around data. It's around collection of data, it's around deployment of data, around the ability of that data to cross NHS borders and to share that data and that good business practice. Now, of course it will, yes.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Brian Whittle, for giving way. We were on Health Committee in the last session together, and data was a big issue, and about data sharing. Do you think that because of the work that Chest, Heart, Stroke Scotland are doing, that it's something that maybe needs to be connected directly with the data platforms for learning for the GP practices or GPs, for instance?
Brian Whittle.
I do. I think you're absolutely right. Of course, you know, having been on the committee with me, this is an issue that has recurred with me over and over, this ability to collect and share data. I think, though, one of the things we always seem to go with all these conditions, MS was one of them as well, is this around this the need to be able to share this information with GPs. I think what's happening, Presiding Officer, is because GPs are under extreme pressure, the actual ability to do consistent development is actually curtailed, and we need to generally have a look at how we allow our GPs to access that learning. But of course, I think you're absolutely right. I think as I come to my presenting officer to say that long COVID clinics, which are not available in Scotland but are available elsewhere in the UK, are not only diagnostic and treatment centres, but they're also that hub to collect that data. Long COVID is real, and we are behind the curve in Scotland as we currently sit. I'll just finish by thanking Jackie Bailey once again for bringing this debate to the Chamber and allowing us to raise this again. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whittle. I now call Cara Mochan to be followed by Fulton McGregor. Mrs. Mochan.
And can I thank my colleague Jackie Bailey for her ongoing work on this issue and bringing today's debate on International Long COVID Day to the Chamber. Can I thank all the colleagues across the Chamber for the contributions, but in particular mention my colleague Mark Griffin's bill is of such importance. As we have heard, long COVID is and will continue to be one of the most challenging outcomes of the pandemic, a condition that debilitates, lacks a cure, lacks research, and sadly still lacks awareness. It is absolutely right that we mark International Long COVID Day, which, as we have heard, is tomorrow, and renew our commitment to all those in Scotland who are suffering as a result of the long-term impacts of the virus. In this debate, yet again, colleagues across the Chamber have warned the Scottish Government about the threat long COVID poses. We have had those suffering with long COVID speak directly to us, to MSPs, highlighting their concerns, as we have heard from members in the Chamber and at other times here in the Scottish Parliament. But I'm not surprised that their demands and requests are met with insufficient actions. It is part of why we keep trying to bring this to the Chamber. Now, members will recognise that I often raise issues on health inequalities, and so I feel Jackie Bailey is right to note in her motion the importance of not creating inequalities in patient outcomes. Research released by SPICE last month highlights, and I quote, "As a proportion of the UK population, the prevalence of self-reported long COVID was greatest in people living in more deprived areas, those working in social care, those aged 16 and over who were not working and not looking for work, and those with another activity limiting health conditions or disability." Of course, we are still behind when it comes to research, and the impacts of long COVID will become clearer as we progress. But, Presiding Officer, we know that this government has totally taken its eye off the ball when it comes to health inequalities, and therefore it is critical, absolutely critical, that we are alert to what could yet be further health inequalities impacting Scots from deprived areas. But before concluding, Presiding Officer, I'm keen to pay tribute to the Health and Activity Rehabilitation Programme team, who work as part of Three Ayrshire's Health and Social Care Partnerships. I was delighted to pay a visit to their base at the Lister Centre in Kilmarnock on Friday and to learn about the long COVID services they will provide in the coming months to those living with the condition in the Ayrshire and Arran Health Board. The team and its staff identified early in the pandemic the need to support staff and did this through an occupational health model. This has given the team a real advantage in recommending their service to lead on long COVID in Ayrshire. It seems to me, from the visit that I had, that clinical leadership, along with a respect for a multidisciplinary approach, is key to the team's outcomes. They have a sort of equal approach across the allied health professions, the nurses, the volunteers and the support staff. And they do fantastic work within the community. And I have no doubt that their long COVID provision can and will be a success. However, as parliamentarians, we owe it to the staff from services such as this to ensure that funding is available and that it is uplifted whenever it is able to do so. I hope the Minister will address the funding issues raised across the Chamber today. As people look for support to help deal with breathlessness, fatigue, tiredness and other symptoms, we have to be in a position to offer it. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. And I now call Fulton MacGregor, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond to the debate. Mr MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This week marks the third anniversary of when we began to fully understand the scale at which the COVID pandemic was going to affect our lives. In the years since, we have seen rapid scientific breakthroughs, communities pulling together, and a fundamental shift in the way we live our lives. And I want to put on record my welcome for the work of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee on a range of issues relating to the pandemic, including the issue of long COVID, for which we are here to discuss this evening. We are still continuing to fully understand this condition, but generally speaking, as others have said, we can describe long COVID as being an individual takes months to recover, if at all, from COVID symptoms and suffers from persistent issues such as fatigue, high temperatures, breathlessness, cognitive impairment, generalised pain and mental health problems, but to name a few. And also, like others in this chamber, I have been contacted by many constituents who have had their lives significantly affected by their struggles with long COVID. One constituent, who is only 27 years old, has been off work for 2 years and suffers every day with constant pain. Although he has been told by doctors that he is suffering from long COVID, he is waiting for further diagnostic tests with the NHS and is having trouble accessing necessary benefits and supports as he awaits his tests. He tells me that recently he managed to reach an agreement with his employers to allow him to return to work. This is very promising, and indeed I know this local company and firm, but perhaps, I think as others have raised, not all employers will be as understanding or as informed about long COVID. Another constituent was only 14 when he contracted COVID during the first wave of the pandemic. Now 17 years old, he has withdrawn from school, withdrawn from his social network, and his dreams of learning how to drive and attend university have been put on hold indefinitely. Doctors have diagnosed him with long COVID and now believe he suffers from severe chronic fatigue syndrome. His mother, Tracy McMillan, has expressed her appreciation for the GPs and healthcare professionals that have helped her son up to now, but she has also expressed frustration that clinical support for cases like her son are near non-existent. And I have raised this situation for Mrs McMillan and her son before in this chamber, and I know that she has also presented to the COVID committee and submitted to the inquiry. Of course, this is not to say that the Scottish Government has been inactive in this area, as some of the commentary has suggested tonight. In September 2021, the Scottish Government set up the Long COVID Service. This service uses an evidence-based approach to provide supported self-management, primary care, community-based support, rehabilitation and secondary care services, if necessary, to those with long COVID. And this initiative was financed by a £10 million long COVID support package, which was given to local health boards to respond to the situation. My local health board of NHS Lanarkshire uses a long COVID rehabilitation pathway, which offers dietitians, occupational therapists, physiotherapists, psychological practitioners, speech and language therapists, amongst others, to those who are referred onto the pathway by their GPs.
Yeah, of course. Jackie Bailey.
I think we would all welcome the £10 million given by the Scottish Government, but it is over 3 years, and it's not the £21.7 million that they've actually received in Barnett consequentials. Does he agree with me that it would be helpful to put all of the money into the system to help long COVID sufferers?
Mr. MacGregor?
I thank Jackie Bailey for that intervention. I do think we're still understanding long COVID, and we have to welcome money, but I do think that it is likely that more needs to be done, and I'm going to go on to develop that point. I was speaking about NHS Lanarkshire situation there, Presiding Officer. I'm due to meet with the team, the rehabilitation team there soon, to hear more about their work, and I have heard very good things about the work that they're doing. NHS Lanarkshire also published a long COVID self-management workbook on their website, which offers individuals a number of ways to alleviate symptoms and lists a number of other supports available if required. To conclude, Presiding Officer, 3 years on, we know that long COVID exists. We know it can be debilitating. In fact, some people have said that this is the pandemic after the pandemic. We know that people suffering from it experience a wide range of symptoms. Local health boards have protocols in place to provide some aid, but a much greater investment is needed in order to provide support in cases like those of my constituents that I mentioned earlier. As well as providing health assistance, we must make sure that the social security network does not allow anyone suffering from long COVID to slip through. And I'll finish on that point, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. MacGregor. I now call on Minister Marie Todd to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm very pleased to respond to this debate on behalf of the Government. I hope to respond to many of the points that have been raised and set out the Scottish context, and of course, again, reiterate our commitment to supporting people with long COVID. International Long COVID Day tomorrow is an important opportunity to reflect on the impact which COVID-19 has had and continues to have on those adults and children who experience persisting symptoms. Now, these symptoms can vary considerably in their presentation and impact from person to person and can have significant effects right across many areas of life. And I want to take an opportunity to pay tribute to our dedicated health and social care and third sector staff across Scotland who have been working tirelessly since the beginning of the pandemic to support people with long COVID. Now, unfortunately, as has been mentioned by many in the Chamber, at present there are no broadly effective treatments for long COVID. The recommended approach and clinical guidance is to provide treatment where possible for specific symptoms or to support to help people to manage them. Now, this is being supported in Scotland through local primary care teams who will conduct tests to investigate symptoms, to provide direct support or access to other services. They might also include the third sector, community rehabilitation, mental health services, and for a smaller proportion of patients, further investigation of specific complications delivered in a specific specialty clinic or hospital setting. Yes, I will.
Alex Gough-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way. This is what it says on the tin. This is what the government has said for the best part of 18 months now, but it's not what's happening in real life. Now, I said in my remarks that the government is gaslighting victims and sufferers of long COVID by suggesting there is these treatment pathways that just do not exist. What does the Minister have to say to them?
Minister.
So I am absolutely, I find it quite insulting that you're using that term in the Chamber. There is no intention to gaslight patients. However, from listening to those who have been impacted by long COVID, it is very clear that healthcare support and services haven't always met their expectations. We also know that finding the right support can be particularly challenging when people have multiple symptoms or a complex presentation. That's why this government's established that £10 million long COVID support fund that aims to increase the capacity of existing services, supporting those with long COVID. One moment. It aims to develop those into more clearly defined local pathways, and it aims to provide a more coordinated experience for those accessing support.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, and I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way. Research from SPICE has identified that £21.7 million in Barnett consequentials has come to the Scottish Government as a result of NHS England treatment for long COVID. Where has that money gone?
Minister.
I'm sure that Jackie Bailey is aware that we spend more per head of population on health than any other UK government. We have more GPs per head of population. Spending in Scotland is 10.6% higher than England. And I would put to Jackie Bailey and others who have raised the point of services being better in England, RCGP Scotland's written response to the COVID-19 Recovery Committee inquiry on long COVID stated, we note that the English clinics have been hugely expensive for the number of patients treated and that most treatment involves rehabilitation and symptomatic care. So doesn't differ significantly from what's in offer in Scotland other than it is significantly more expensive. We've made an initial £3 million available to NHS boards and partners over this financial year and a further £3 million will be allocated over 23-24. The clinical guidelines, so all of you in this chamber, and I would presume that Dr. Sandesh Gulhani is already familiar with evidence-based guidelines, but the clinical guideline produced by SINE, NICE and the RCGP notes that one model for long COVID service organisation would not fit all areas. That's why we're supporting the NHS boards to develop those tailored models of care delivered by teams with knowledge and expertise of their local populations. For example, between May 22 and January this year, NHS Lanarkshire's long COVID rehabilitation pathway, as mentioned by my colleague Fulton MacGregor, has directed over 580 referrals. This pathway delivers a single point of access for assessment and coordinated support from services, including physiotherapy, occupational therapy, psychology, dietetics and speech and language therapy, depending on what's most appropriate for a person's needs. NHS Highland, where I live, which spans the largest geographical area of all of the Scottish Health Boards, covering 41% of the country's landmass, has developed a long COVID pathway delivered by a virtual team, quite rightly. This includes occupational therapy, physiotherapy and staffing to support assessment, rehabilitation and coordination. And that pathway has had approximately 100 referrals since going live in September 22. I'll give way.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful for the Minister for giving way. Perhaps you would reflect on the fact that Ayrshire and Arran don't have any pathway for anybody with long COVID, except for those within that work within the health board.
You'll be delighted to hear that six health boards do have long COVID pathways up and running. NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and NHS Ayrshire and Arran have indicated that their pathways are expected to open later this month. Elsewhere, other boards are working extremely hard to conclude recruitment processes and have defined long COVID pathways in operation as soon as possible. We've established a national strategic network to ensure initiatives delivered by boards are robustly evaluated, helping to spread that best practice and learning as quickly and effectively as possible. But there's still a great deal to be learned regarding long COVID, which is why we're contributing to the worldwide research effort to better understand the condition. And our Chief Scientist Office is funding 9 research projects investigating the longer-term effects of COVID, totalling £2.5 million. Initial findings from a number of them have been published in peer review scientific journals. Now, more broadly, our CSO research funding schemes are open, and I have to be absolutely clear, applications on long COVID are welcomed. Now, ventilation was mentioned earlier in the debate. We know that can make an important contribution to reducing the risk of transmission. Expert advice from bodies including SAGE and the Health and Safety Executive indicates that air cleaning and filtration devices such as HEPA filters aren't a substitute for efforts to improve ventilation in order to mitigate against the risks of COVID, and we're taking forward the recommendations of our Ventilation Short Life Working Group, which aims to raise awareness of the importance of ventilation, increase technical skills and improve air quality in buildings. Lastly, as I close, Presiding Officer, it would be remiss of me not to recognise the work of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee and the work that it's currently undertaken and the wealth of information that it's amassed from academics, healthcare practitioners and, most importantly, people with lived experience of this condition. This is a brand new condition, and yet in Scotland we've already done a great deal. We've issued national guidance, we supported research into the condition, we've established a fund to support the development of services, set up a national strategic network to ensure learning between NHS boards and the sharing of evidence into long COVID. Now, I recognise that would be no comfort to individuals who are suffering and who are finding it hard to navigate care. But it's really important that we are dealing with a condition that we are still learning about. All of this has been done within the context of an NHS under immense pressure as a result of the pandemic. There's one final thing I want to correct before I close, and I find myself obliged to correct just one of Alec Cole-Hamilton's inaccuracies, and that is that this is actually the third time that this Parliament has debated long COVID. The last time we debated it was in May last year in government time. The government remains committed to drawing upon the best available insight and evidence to inform our evolving approach to supporting people with long COVID. And we look forward to engaging with the Parliament on this issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.